I'm going to talk about the instrument of Japu, of Chinese genealogies in and of themselves. This came about, this particular presentation came about from a paper I was asked to write at the Family History Library in Salt Lake on how to read Japu. And if you folks recall, I'm one of these, Chinese Americans who didn't grow up speaking Chinese. I didn't start studying Mandarin until I was in college. And and I ended up putting together a paper that I think has been useful for people like me who don't read a lot of Chinese. So, for those of you, you come to this conference and you listen to, Henry and Amy and Patrick, and you find out, where your village is, and you finally end up going there, and you get your Japu, then what? Okay? Then, of course, you contact Gene Chin or Patrick and say, translate this for me. Okay? What I'm trying to encourage you to do is not just to set it aside and wait for somebody to help out. The paper I've written is one that I've talked to a lot of people who have just rudimentary Chinese. I mean, if you look at Chinese characters and it's just chicken scratches, it won't do you any good. But if you can at least get used to differentiating characters, and I've pushed some people who, hardly had any Chinese to just say, there's formulaic parts of Chinese genealogies that are, there's patterns to them. And so if you learn just a few characters, you can start to wend your way through the pedigree portions of these genealogies. There's data tables where you can start to look under a name and start to understand when they were born and when they died and how many sons they had, different names that they were given over their lifetimes. That portion is not that hard to get through. And if you're able to do that with your own genealogies, it's a very rewarding experience. I promise you that, be able to trace through ancestries and the generations and get down to where, here's my grandfather, here's my father. It's a neat thing to do. The other thing is you'll see that it's also a valuable research tool to have in your pocket, because as you are researching and looking for villages, you're going to want to consult sometimes with other related genealogies to see what you can learn to point you in the right direction. And I'll give you an example of this quickly from my own experience. By the way, this paper that I wrote, I'm going to give you a reference on how to find it online. It's also on the Southern Chinese Family History Group's website and on their DVD, and I'll probably even post the paper on the Dropbox as well, so you'll all have it. But and the other thing is that I'm going to, if I get to that portion before we go to lunch, I'm going to just hit some highlights of that paper on and point some things out. If I don't get there, the greater benefit is when you sit down with a genealogy and with the paper. You won't learn it from just, a few minutes of me talking about it. So, and I've kind of put more and more stuff into this to make it more interesting on genealogies as a whole. This is the village of my paternal grandmother. She's a Lum or a Lin, okay? Again, forgive me, most of my references are going to be in Mandarin, because I don't speak Toisanese or Cantonese. This is the Dragon Peace Village, the Long An Tsun. It took me about 5 years of searching for this village. I finally found it in November of 2017, so not very long ago, and I won't go into the whole story of how I found this village, but there's an interesting experience that happened with me. Just some pictures of the village. That's an aerial shot of the village. This is the day I found it with my newfound cousins, and this one right here is a cousin that I've become close to, and we stay in touch on WeChat all the time and have had a lot of interaction. When I asked if they had a Japu, they at first told me they didn't. And then they brought this thing out, and I kind of titled this, Not How to Take Care of a Japu. because it's you can see it's kind of falling apart. And they brought out another a better copy, but it turns out that this what Japu they had really was of later generations, not even from my branch. And so this portion of the of it didn't do me any good. And they said, we really don't have anything beyond this. They were actually able to put together on a, you know, write down for me from my great-grandfather, who was all I knew, you know, that's the furthest generation I had. They wrote out six generations more and got it back to the village founder, who founded the village in 1707. Okay? So it did get me back six or seven generations. What they wrote out for me was my great-grandfather, and that gets back to a guy named Lin Chong Chan, who founded the village in 1707. And the interesting thing is, it says right here, if you can read it, 11th generation, and that's the character for generation. Same, and I said, okay, you know, generation numbers are so important to the Chinese. I said, who's generation number one? And they said, we don't know, you know. We don't know anything before him. So, Lin Chong Chan, generation number 11. I started researching. Actually, before finding the village, I had been researching. But this is another genealogy from a village I visited earlier that I thought might give some clues as I was searching for the village. And from their genealogy, the page from their genealogy, and some others that I studied, and by looking at the generation patterns, I figured out this guy, whose name is Lin Gongbi, was generation number one. And I found an area in Toisan, in the northern part of Toisan, that he came to back in the 1300s, this Lin Gongbi. And so the next year, I went back with my cousin to the area where this Lin Gongbi had come to, searching for their genealogies to see if I could find my ancestor, my village founder, Lin Chongsan, in their genealogies and fill in the missing gap of these 11 generations. Because from the Lin genealogies, I mean, the Lin genealogies are like the Chan family and the Huang family is very well established from Huang Di all the way down, and I could trace it all the way down to this Lin Gongbi. So I had this 11-generation gap to fill in that would link me up to the Yellow Emperor on this line. So we went to this area. It's called Daling, up in the Shuibu area of Toisan, and started at the office, the local committee office, looking with the committee head, and went out searching the various villages. There's a cluster of lean villages in that area. Ended up going in a weekend, over a weekend, about a dozen of these villages. About half of them had genealogies, about half of them didn't. You know, some of them just, you know, they're lost or were destroyed, or somebody went to America and took it, and, you know, they just didn't know. We looked at about half of them. These are just us searching. This was one from this village, from this person, and I scanned it. Unfortunately, it didn't have my ancestor in it, and we kind of struck out. Again, just searching. This was the oldest village in the area, and we spent about 3 hours there, and I had some other genealogies that they were very interested in, and we talked, and we, you know, kind of went through the different pedigree charts and that, but they didn't have the genealogy, their genealogy. About a week later, they called us back, and they said, we were tearing down this building in the village. This is the building right here. And amongst the rubble, they found a box. And this is what they found in the box, a genealogy of 288 pages. And there we are looking at it. And this page here, you can't see it very well, but it has Lin Gongbi and his two sons, and it starts with his oldest son here, and if you count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, let's see, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. There's Lin Chongsan. And it says that he moved to the San Hlamgap area, the Sanhe area, and it gives the name, an alternate name of the village, which the village knew. But that's how I was able to fill in the gaps here. So this isn't typical of how you find a genealogy, okay? You don't go to a village and say, do you have a genealogy? And they say no, and you don't say, well, let's start tearing down some buildings. Maybe we can find it. But, you know, just be persistent. You never know. You know, Tom and I have a good friend who lives in Malaysia, Philip Tan, who's an excellent genealogist, who also doesn't read Chinese. But he always says, you know, I always feel like I'm getting spiritual help when I'm doing this. These ancestors want to be found and want to be remembered. And so you never know when something like this is going to come your way. So anyway, let me go on. Oh, my cousin wrote me January, and he said that, you know, he wrote this message that was going out to everybody, that the brothers and sisters of the Long Island Village, the ancestral tablet has been erected in the upper and lower village hall, and they set a time for a ceremony for everybody to gather. And so from the information that we had now from this genealogy, they were able to put this ancestral tablet together in the community hall, going from generation number one of Lin Gongbi and all the way down through Lin Chongsan. And this is some pictures of that. And he said, afterwards, after the sacrificial offerings are performed, we'll distribute this new village genealogy. So to be able to contribute to my village's restoring their heritage, you know, for, you know, some third, fourth generation Chinese, doesn't get any better than this. So let me talk a little bit about the history of genealogy in China. And this won't do it justice. Henry mentioned a scholar named Mel Thatcher, and I've sat in a class with him 16 sessions for 2 hours going over the history of genealogy and local gazetteers throughout the dynastic history of China. Okay, you can really get in depth on this, and I'm going to give you 2 minutes. Okay, the important thing to know is that genealogies have held a prominent position in Chinese culture and society that you don't find anywhere else. I mean, you know, when somebody applies to join the civil service, nobody in government here says, well, let's take a look at your genealogy and see if you're suitable for hiring here, you know. Or if you go to get married, well, let's check and see your lineage. See if, you know, our family wants your family, because we got to see if, you know, what kind of people you have in your genealogy. Or, you know, when your family is dividing things up, do you look at the rules in your genealogy for, you know, how the property is supposed to be divided? Chinese genealogies, the earliest writings in Chinese civilization, back with the oracle bones and bronze inscriptions, had genealogical information on them. In fact, the great historian of China, Sima Qian, who wrote the grand history of China back before the time of Christ, around that time, most of that, I think, he put together from researching genealogies when he started his writings in Chinese history. From about 1000 BC, you start to find imperial pedigrees. Nobility and gentry classes had genealogies. There were surname registries, and there were government bureaus that kept these. Again, why? Because the government was staffed through using genealogies and keeping it within certain classes and families to keep the government running. During the Song Dynasty, again, now we're talking about 960 to 1280 AD, there was a great reformation transformation, a revival of genealogies during this period of time. And most of the genealogies that you'll find from your villages go back to about this period of time, when you're going back about 30 generations. This is the time when genealogy started to flourish amongst the private families. Confucianism had taken hold, and so they were no longer using genealogies because they were now using the Confucian examination system to appoint government officials. But two scholars, Ouyang Shou and Su Shun, were scholars that kind of led this revival, and they put together a five-generation format that is still, you still find it today. And frankly, a lot of people don't put too much trust in genealogical information before the Song Dynasty, because usually from the Song Dynasty before, it's a single pedigree line coming down from the Yellow Emperor of male names, and it's based upon a mix of history and legend and myth. Okay. But I found from the Song Dynasty on that usually that information is really pretty good and pretty accurate. In the Ming and Qing dynasties, these genealogies became even more sophisticated, and they added more and more categories into the preface material. And I'll show you some of the an example of that later. There's moral education was emphasized. Greater generations, numbers of generations were included. And like I said, the topics were expanded. And in the modern era, there's been a resurgence of genealogies. In Taiwan, it flourished since the end of, the national government, when the nationalists were sent to Taiwan, they were able to keep up the traditions there. Of course, there was a lull in keeping genealogies in the PRC until after the Cultural Revolution, because they went through this period of time of trying to drive out old things, including genealogies, when many genealogies were unfortunately destroyed during that period of time. So let me give you a few tips on searching for genealogies, searching for Japu. Again, this is consistent with what we've said. Start with your own family. You search for your own family or your own ancestral village, because that is the most direct way of finding your family's genealogy. Henry said that yesterday. He said, the only way to do it is to find your village and find your genealogy. There are other ways to research, but it's difficult to find them. FamilySearch.org, I'll show you how to search the collection there. Again, about 30 to 40,000 genealogies they have in the collection now. And they're expanding every year as they continue to collect. The Shanghai Library has about 50,000 physical copies of genealogies, and they've put together a big catalog that's a useful place to look. This is just an example of a genealogy that I got from a family member, just this Xerox copy of it. This is all that exists. And you can see that portions of it are missing. I just want to point out that this genealogy has more accurate information that I found in the village genealogy pertaining to my family. So the closer you get, this was probably kept in the home of my grandfather's older brother, probably written in his hand. And in fact, this is my grandfather, and it talks about his birth date and his wife, my grandmother, and it talks about his birth date in Chinese calendar date. And whenever I find a Chinese calendar date, I generally trust it more than any Western date that they have written down, because our ancestors who first immigrated, they thought in terms of Chinese calendars, not Western calendars, okay? And when they converted it, they did it in funny ways back then, because they didn't have tables and things like that. And as a matter of fact, this is the grandmother I showed yesterday, where I found her delayed report of birth certificate, that she was born in Hilo, Hawaii. I now, from looking at and getting an accurate date and looking at another document that I found online in Hawaii, actually have revised things because I'm pretty sure she was now born in Maui and wasn't Hilo that they put down in the delayed report of birth. Anyway, that's a whole other story. But let me show you how to search for genealogies in the familysearch.org website. Okay, and again, this is going back to the search page that you first come up with, and I talked about indexed records on this portion. Over here, there's a map, and it says search by location. If you click on Asia, it comes up with Asian countries. And if you click on China, it comes up with some lists of materials. And right here, there says collection, China collection of genealogies, okay? 13 million images for you to peruse, okay? That figure is now at about 50 million, okay? But unfortunately, in this particular browse collection, they haven't been adding to it there. They're making us go to a different method of searching for them, and I've been bugging them to, you know, put it back here because it's easier for Chinese Americans like us to search in this method. And I'll show you how it works. If you click on that, there's a place that says browse through these images, and it now points you to waypoints. So you pick a surname. You're starting to narrow the search. You pick your own surname, okay? In this example, I picked Chun, and then it says what country, because there's various countries that we've collected Chun genealogies from. And I picked China, and then you can narrow it further in China by the province, okay? So I'm going to pick Taishan. I'm going to pick Guangdong province, and then it gives you the county, and I'm going to pick Taishan County. And there it gives me 5 titles, okay, to look through of Chun genealogies that we have collected from Taishan, okay? Not a lot when you think about the fact that there's, 400 Chun villages in Taishan, okay? But we have 5 of them at least, okay? From there, it takes you to the images. You click on one and you can start to look at a Chinese genealogy, and there's the title page. There's some of the narrative, and as you turn further, you can get into the pedigree charts, okay? Once you get into this, it's not really user-friendly because you got to thumb through, you know, maybe 1,000 images to search what you're looking for, okay? We're trying to get to the point where you can press a button and it'll search for a name within that, but we're not at that point yet. The Family Search has a great amount of people that are indexing records. To index a Chinese genealogy is much more complicated because it's hard to understand where the relationships are because the trees branch to so many different pages, and it's just a much more complicated beast, and we're trying to figure that out on how to best do that. So right now, as I said, searching for your genealogy, it's better to go find your village than it is to try and find your genealogy in this method. Because when you look at a genealogy like this, when you finally get down, if you only have like a grandfather, great-grandfather's name, when you start to get down to generation number 30, 31, 32, you're looking at, because it cascades down and branches off, you're looking at, you know, hundreds of names across that generation. And so it's difficult. If you have a name of your grandfather, like Patrick taught, but you don't have the right name of your grandfather, you know, you only have his Ming and not his Zi or his Hao, that it might be listed different in there, that's another impediment to finding this genealogy that belongs to you in this collection, if we have it. But just finding it out is difficult going. I actually met 2 people once. I gave a presentation, and these 2 people who worked in the family history library, they came to me and said, we both found our genealogies, you know, through this, and found our grandparents. And I felt like that was a bigger miracle than me finding the book in the building that was being torn down. So it can be difficult. But again, don't shy away from this, because get my paper and start to practice at least going through genealogies to see if you can start reading these, because it's a neat thing to do. Here's how you search for the other millions of images that we have. You have to go to the catalog now. Again, you search under search, you go to the catalog, and you start plugging in the place. Here I put Guangdong province in China, and I put in the Chun surname in the surname field. Okay, and there's other fields too that are important. There's a keyword field that's kind of a catch-all, and in there you can put an ancestor's name, or here I just put Taishan, and when I click on that search, it comes up with genealogies as well. And so that's another way to search through the FamilySearch.org catalog to look for genealogies. Okay, here's the Shanghai Library Index. Okay, the Shanghai Library Catalog, it's a 10-volume set. They keep saying that they're going to put out a digital copy of this that's searchable. They haven't done it yet, and I'm still waiting. But I did search, so you have to look through these in hard copy. I did search through WorldCat, and in the area here, you can find copies of this at NYU. Columbia University has a set, and also Queens Public Library has a set. And you folks from New York Public Library, I'd encourage you to get a set if you can. It's a good resource. It came about from a study that was, well, it was a joint project actually with FamilySearch. FamilySearch participated with the Shanghai Library putting this together. And they cataloged 50,000 genealogies here. And I'll show you an entry. The way it's organized by surname, so you look through an index by stroke order and you find what surname you're looking for. And then within the surname field, then you look by location, by province, okay? So here's an entry that's in there, and I'll just show you. This says, this is for my family surname, the one family surname. And it shows you here the area is Guangdong, and it's a place called Xinning, and then it gives you the title of the genealogy, okay? And then this gives you some publishing information. Here it talks about some prominent, the Shurzu, the who's the first ancestor in the record. And it gives the names, and this is one of my prominent ancestors, is why I look this up, and it's so it's relevant to me. And then the last line, it tells you Zhongshan Tu. You can find this in the Zhongshan Library, or the Xinning Tu, the Xinning Tushuguan, or the Xinning Dang, the Dang'an, the archives in Xinning. So it tells you the location where you can find this genealogy in China, okay? Sometimes you'll see a reference that'll say Meiguo Yota, which is America, Utah. That means FamilySearch has that one. Okay? That's what the reference is. So again, useful to trying to find a genealogy if you know your surname and you're looking for your particular area, what genealogies you might find. And there's other websites that you can find from different libraries. This isn't comprehensive. Again, this will be on the Dropbox so you can get them. I'm finding that somebody that I know in Hong Kong has documented some of the other libraries in the area, and I'll probably try and see if I can get those as a reference point for people as well. Here's where to find my paper on reading genealogies. It's in FamilySearch.org under the research wiki. And I showed you how to find that yesterday, but there's the instructions on how to find it, okay? Now, let me go into very quickly. How are we doing on time? Is everybody about to drop dead? All right, let me go very quickly through this portion. Again, here's where I start to talk about, just to hit the highlights of what's in the paper. Okay, terms for genealogy. You've heard this jiapu, zupu, zongpu, Okay, those are the three most common terms that you find for genealogies. Henry talked about this yesterday. And sometimes, again, they refer to different levels of japu, where a zongpu is kind of more for the whole clan. The zupu is can have several branches. The japu is a little more localized. In a lot of times, just in regular conversations, the Chinese will admit they use these terms kind of interchangeably anyway, but they can be specific in terms. Okay, so reading titles, when you start to look at a japu, you first want to look at the title, okay? And so the first thing to note is you'll have a surname and then the character for sure and then japu. So this is a Li Shir Japu, the Li clan japu, or a Chen Shir Zupu, okay? And a Tan Shir Zongpu. So you'll see that term usually in any title of a genealogy. Sometimes it'll refer to a branch. So if you look at this, here is a Wen Shir Zupu, but it says here Tai Yuan Tang, okay? They name branches in different ways, but that's one way that it names it. It's after a temple in Tai Yuan. Many times it's by location. And so if you look towards the end, here is a Wang Shir Zongpu, and it is from Fujian and Ningde in the 9th district, Zhoudu, and it gives the name of the village, Guicun. So that's all in the title there. Sometimes it's by ancestor. This is a Lin or a Lum genealogy, and Shuedong Bunzu. Bunzu is another term for the primogenitor ancestor. This is a genealogy referring to this ancestor, okay? So those are different ways. So just looking at this, what does this title tell you? It is a Wang Zupu. It's a Wang genealogy, okay? Very good. Here's another one. This says Hunan, and it's a Tan genealogy, okay? This one gets a little more detailed, but again, it's a place name, and then below that it is another Lin genealogy, Lum genealogy. Okay. Let me talk about the prefaces that you find in these genealogies. In my paper, it won't help you to read the prefaces, because they're just in narrative form. And most often, if it's an old genealogy, it is in classical Chinese, which makes it even harder, okay? And in fact, many Chinese have a hard time with this. Even if they know, if they've studied classical Chinese, sometimes they have a hard time with genealogies, because the families usually wanted to make a good impression when they put these together, and they'd hire some family scholar, and it would have obscure references that only the family knows. It can be rough going, but there is rich information in this, and so don't ignore it. But you gotta then, after you've read through the parts you can go through, you find somebody like Patrick who knows how to read this stuff, and say, Patrick, help me. Patrick hates when I do this because everybody goes to him. So. Here's a table of contents. You can see all the different kinds of things that an expanded genealogy gets into in these narratives now. And they can be very extensive. Ancestral hall sketches, they can talk about achievements of ancestors. They can give portraits. They have tomb sketches and talk about where tombs are. So in this narrative portion, there are a few things that you can try and pick out. And one is, again, just this term, Shirzu, the name of the primogenitor, usually the generation number one ancestor. So there's a term that is important to know. Here's another one, a variation of that, called the Shirchenzu. Okay, that's a migrant. That Chen means to migrate, to move. So it's the migrant ancestor. Okay, as clans start out and you have a first Shirzu, there's a the branches break off as families move and reestablish, and usually the count starts over again at generation number one with another Shirchenzu. So I can have in one genealogy, I had my Shirchenzu who was generation number one, and I found another book, he was generation 167 in another book, okay? And then there's the Shoshing Shirzu, the one who received the surname. So those are important to look for. Patrick went over the different types of surnames, and he talked a lot about generation names, and so I won't go into that too much. But here it shows you in a preface that this ancestor, his Hui, which is a taboo name, was Jing, his Zi, his style name was Zhou Mu, and his Hao, the courtesy name, was Wen Ning. So that there, again, it shows you if you pick those out. The pedigree charts, or the Shishi Tus, these are important terminology to know. The Shir is for designates the count. You'll see generation number one, Yi Shir Zu, Zu for ancestor. Ar Shir Zu, many times this will just say Shir Zu, and then it'll go to Ar Shir Zu, San Shir Zu. But you'll find those markers to get you through the generations. You'll find alongside of the male names, terms for it'll be before a female's name, which would be the wife, okay? It'll be a Bi or a Pei or a Chu. Sometimes there's others, but those are the prominent ones. And then you'll see this Zi, and you'll see the sons designated. And you'll see instead of the first son, it'll say Chang Zi, okay, for the oldest son. And Zi Zi, the next son. And then the third son, fourth son, etc. So those are terms that will help you follow along through the genealogy. This looks complicated, but this is one of the Ouyang Shou five-generation formats, and it shows that this ancestor here, Sheng Tang, had his second son, Cizi, was named this, and that's the 13th generation, and it shows his name here. And over here in this data, it gives the names of his sons. And it focuses on who, he had five sons, gave birth to five sons, and who becomes the 14th generation. Okay, so it just follows along like that. That's how it follows along. And you have five generations to a page. The hard thing is that they don't always tell you what page to look for after you get to the end of the page. Okay? Usually not. Here's another one that you find in a typical tree, or pyramid pattern. And again, fifth generation, sixth generation, seventh generation, and it starts to split. And then there's the eighth generation. Okay? And so you can see, again, the generation numbers right there. Here you can see they list wives sometimes like that. Okay? And again, you all know the wives are by surname only with the character of Shir or Xi, and they only give the surname. Here's another pattern. Again, that goes from right to left, giving generation numbers above, et cetera. There are portions that have biographical tables in them where you'll find, sometimes it's together with the pedigree chart, sometimes it's a separate table. And they give, usually, typically, they'll tell you, like I had in that first five-generation plan, it shows you the numbers of sons they have. It'll give you a birth date and a death date very often. It'll sometimes give you burial data where they'll talk about the burial site and what position the body is laid in according to feng shui and things like that. I don't find that portion too informational. I mean, it's kind of obscure as far as the burial information, but the dates are important. And so as you go through, these are just more data tables. I have a whole section on how to read the Chinese calendar. I don't think I'll go through it with you today. If you want to see me during the later period and you're interested, I'll show you the 60-year Chinese calendar date is put together, okay, that, you know, sometimes I post this and say, I want you all to memorize this table. But it shows you how there are using the 10 heavenly stems and the 12 earthly branches, that they use those in combination to make the names of the years. And that magically creates 60 pairs of unique names that repeat every 60 years. And so therefore you have a 60-year calendar. And of course, to distinguish, since that name repeats, you got to use the name of an emperor to distinguish what year you're talking about. Okay? And so I show you how to read that, and it's a neat skill to have. There's a website that I usually use from Taiwan, where it's in Chinese, unfortunately, but you can plug in the information of a Chinese calendar date, and it converts the Western calendar date for you. The fun thing about that is it has a section as well. It's right there. You plug in the information here, and it gives you the date. You can also put in a Western date and find the Chinese calendar date. So the fun thing is kind of put your own birth date and see when you were born according to the Chinese calendar. It's kind of a fun thing to do. You can also, in Family Tree, the Family Tree portion of FamilySearch.org, if you open any person page where you're going to fill in a date and you can cut and paste Chinese characters into that field, they have a feature there that it automatically converts the date for you. So that's an easy way to do it as well. Again, I'm available to show you that sort of thing. So that's basically the introduction to Jiapu that I wanted to give you all, and hope that you'll have fun in taking my paper and reading Jiapu and getting into it. Don't shy away from this. Next year, I want to have a progress report from each of you on how you did.